Okay, I couldn't be more excited to have you as we go deeper into step two. So let's see what we've got going here. What's step two? Again, it's identity matters. And in this section, we're going to discuss confirming your identity. It's important that you confirm your identity. So that's what we're going to do. What's our game plan? Well, more identity matters. Specifically, what are you calling yourself today? For example, are you calling yourself a sinner? Or are you specifically calling yourself a child or a son or daughter of God? Does it match what God calls you? So that's our game plan as we look at this section. What about this word confirm? Well, I put a definition or two down here for you from the free dictionary. Probably should take this into consideration as we look at these verses. Confirm means to support or establish the certainty or validity of, verify. It's to make firmer or strengthen. So we want to strengthen your identity here. We want to establish the certainty of it. And I believe God's going to do that here as we look at His Word. So, regarding identity matters, when we see sinner in the Bible, we need to be careful because identity is foundational if you want to crush it. Okay? This is for victorious living. So, if you want to crush it, identity is key. And then recognize that Jesus died and rose to restore your identity. You were born, according to the Bible, as an orphan, estranged from God. And that's why you needed to come to Jesus so that God would adopt you into his family. So, this is all good news, and we're going to look more closely at it regarding your identity. Do you really want to miss out on this identity matter? I pose the question to you. And I know that the answer is, of course, you don't. You don't want to miss out on this. So, let's confirm your identity as we look at God's Word. As we start off, let's read through this scripture together. Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. He says, I give tithes of all that I get, but the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Jesus says, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. So, what happened here? Two men, you could conclude here, were not justified as they prayed because one left justified. And the other didn't. Who left justified? The sinner did. He called himself a sinner and he was asking for God's mercy. He recognized that he was a sinner. But what happened? Jesus said he went down justified. So something changed. He was justified before God. Here's a term. Or a phrase that you might equate to remember what justification means or justified. You may have heard it before, just as if I'd never sinned. So Jesus looked at that man in this parable and said, hey, this guy was justified by how he approached God. But here's the question to you. So let's say that you're in that prayer. Before you come to Jesus and you decide, hey, I need Jesus. I need salvation. Well, here's a picture of a Christian as they approach the cross. And as Jesus said, boom, justified because you came to the cross with the right heart. Now what? Are you still a sinner? Now that you've come to the cross and you've been justified? I would offer no way. But more importantly, it's not so much my opinion. What does God say about it? So I want to encourage you with some new wine from God. God wants you to be established and to confirm your identity. I'll pose another question. What happens when Christ saves a sinner? Are they changed? Do they become a son or daughter or remain a sinner? So it's kind of the same question reinforced here that we just looked at with the picture of the cross.